I'm joined today by many friends of fellowship who make Sunday mornings possible. We're grateful to have music this morning from our choir and Ellen. Great to have the choir back after a little over 2 years. Gratitude to all who made today's service possible. We are an intentionally welcoming congregation and invite you to be a part of the community. When we make this statement, we are stating our vision of love and acceptance. We welcome you, your backgrounds and beliefs, all racial and ethnic identities, sexual orientation and gender identities, and theological perspectives. You are welcome and accepted. If you have questions about this congregation or the UU faith, ask a member or chat with one of our greeters or speak with me. This morning, Bob Clegg is joining us. He's been a good friend throughout the COVID season and before. He has a Master's of Divinity degree and is a lay community minister. He's a member of the UU Congregation of Frederick, Maryland. Please help me in welcoming Bob, and we will now do our cello slide for us.
Nope, no we won't.
Which calls to mind
a similar approach to Christmas that Linda did for you just a few months ago. Horus and his damaged eye became symbols of life and rebirth. And Dionysus, for just another of her many examples, Dionysus was a divine child who was resurrected by his grandmother. Dionysus also brought his mom, Semele, back to life. The interesting thing is, in the ancient world, wherever you had popular resurrected god myths, Christianity found a lot of converts. People were already thinking along those lines. It was plausible. So, eventually, Christianity came to an accommodation with the pagan spring festival. Today, many churches are offering sunrise services at Easter, an obvious pagan solar celebration. The date of Easter is not fixed, but it's governed by the phases of the moon. How pagan is that, right? All the fun things about Easter, the fun things about Easter are pagan. Bunnies are a leftover from pagan festivals. Easter eggs are an ancient custom. Easter is essentially a pagan festival celebrated with cards, gifts, and novelty Easter products because it's fun and the ancient symbolism still works. What better way to celebrate than to bite the head off of the bunny goddess, go to a sunrise service, and help yourself to a hefty slice of pagan simmel cake. Happy Easter, everyone. We light our chalice with those words. Opening hymn this morning is hymn number 61. Please stand in body or in spirit. Number 61, Lo, the Earth Awakes Again.
I would like to ask Jane Terraby to come and do our board announcements. I beg your pardon on all this. I am a little bit jet lagged right now.
After such stirring music and inspiring words, I get the mundane stuff. There are four announcements. Anyone interested in how we care for our place, our building and grounds, please attend the brainstorming session here at UUFE on Saturday, April 30th at 2 o'clock. It's a thinking, not a doing event. Bring your favorite drinks and snacks. And Tom Arnold, our president, is leading that effort. The silent auction begins this Thursday. Please check out all of our offerings on our website. Keep scrolling over the 20 different items offered. The auction will be online only from Thursday to Sunday. Laura, Beth, and Tofu will be available at the in-person game day as well as next Sunday to assist anyone who wants help getting online. Our lovely Bozena has offered voice lessons in our auction this year. So stop singing in the car and start singing with friends. We can even sing at the Hartons Outdoor Family-Friendly Movie Night while munching on different flavors of popcorn. Get ready to start bidding on Thursday. And game day is coming this Saturday. Please consider joining us in person at 3 or online at 7 p.m. You're welcome to attend either or both events. To maximize your fun, buy your party pack today. You will only need one party pack to attend both events, and we'll be selling them after service for a suggested donation of $20 or more. Remember, this is our annual spring fundraiser. Please join the fun and games and donate generously. And finally, the native plant sale is coming. Information will be sent out this week, and you can actually see what plants will be available after service today. See Sally Woodall's computer at the card table next to the front door. Sign up with the email address to receive the catalog and order form.
Thank you, Jane. Now that we've heard about some of the fun, social, and other activities that are happening here, please join me in saying our covenant this morning.
We seek to nurture spiritual and intellectual growth for all ages, and to be actively involved in community outreach and service, cherishing diversity and celebrating our oneness with all humanity. We covenant to support each other in the spirit of compassion, respect, and love.
Each week we take time to share what's in our hearts. Today, for those in the sanctuary, please come forward and light your candle, and you may use the microphone here at the podium to talk about your item that you would light your candle for. For those who are online, you may type your request into your item into the chat, and we will read it here at the sanctuary. I'm going to light the first candle this morning for the people of Ukraine and all the other beleaguered areas of the world, for those everywhere who are suffering with illness, hunger, and all the other ills which can affect us. For those joys and sorrows that have been shared, and those that remain in the sanctuary of our hearts, we are grateful. I Our fellowship relies on the generosity of all in our community. This morning, the offering will now be collected and gratefully received.
Thank you.
Our reflection this morning, or meditation in words, is these are by Margaret Wrinkle, who actually did publish it about 6 weeks ago. It's in the New Yorker. Excuse me, not the New Yorker. That's right. I'm going to quote somebody from the New Yorker later on. The New York Times is where this reflection comes from. She wrote a piece that was published about 6 weeks ago titled, What to Do with Spring's Wild Joy in a Burning World. And so she refers to March, I think April. March, she writes, comes in like a lion, except when it comes in like a lamb, or when it comes in like a chorus, a symphony, and a ballet all at once. A performance so breathtaking that it could not possibly be replicated. Yet it is replicated anyway, day after day after day. She says, cue the waking insects stirring in the litter, the leaf litter. Cue the flashing bluebirds swooping from the bare maple branches. And cue the hard brown buds waiting and waiting, waiting all through the winter, but just now beginning to quiver. Any day now, any day, they will warm into blossom. We don't deserve a March like this. We've tortured the earth so thoroughly and for so long that we deserve only the hungry lines of March. We are having an exquisite March anyway. I glory in every tiny iridescent green bee waking to feed on the first vanishing bloodroot flower. Soon there will be trillions and trout lilies. Any day now, trillions and trout lilies. If you tell me I don't deserve this joy, you are telling me nothing I don't already know. The world is on fire, and I'm the one who struck the first match. I did it, and you did it, from the very first hominid to rise up on bare feet and stumble across a field of blooming grass. We have all been burning it down. We are burning it down still, to this very day, this very hour. But I am in love with the mild light of springtime even so. I am in love with the shivering joy of springtime and all the beguiling creatures of springtime. With all you are, listen. Listen for the hum and the quiver of a waking world. The upland chorus frogs are singing. It's a song of full-throated promise. It's beginning again. It's beginning again. I can hardly help greeting it all with joy. And I refuse to quell this joy. We are creatures built for joy. In this troubled world, it would be a crime to snuff out any flicker of happiness that somehow leaps into life. At the very saddest funerals, we can hear a funny story about our lost beloved, and God help us, we laugh. We can stagger out of an appointment where a person in a white coat has given us news that we think we cannot bear to hear. And still, we smile at the baby in the checkout line, clapping our little hands at the balloons by the cash register. This is who we are, the very best of who we are. The world is burning, and there is no time to put down the water buckets. But for just an hour, put down the water buckets anyway. Take your cue from the bluebirds who have no faith in the future, but who build for the future nonetheless. Leaf by leaf and straw by straw, shaping them into a sheltering roundness perfectly fitted to the contours of the future they are making. In the moment of silence to follow, consider these last words from McDougal. Turn your face up to the sky and listen. Listen. The world is shivering into possibility. The world is reminding us that this is what the world does best. New life, rebirth, and the great trees that rises out of ashes. My assignment this morning, the request, is something like this: to present the history of all, or who knows, may well, maybe not all, but present the history of things associated with Easter. It's interesting that we put it that way, that things associated with Easter, rabbits, eggs, food, ham, lamb, parades, egg rolling, and all those things, that we think of those things that are associated with Easter when maybe Easter came to be associated with some of them, if you look at things in chronological order. But look at those things and how they got incorporated into Jewish, Christian, pagan, secular, celebratory traditions. And I'd like to go on from that, since this is a religious meeting. Religion to me meaning something about finding meaning as in this life. And I'd like to go on from that then and ask, what in all of that can we find that helps us both do and enjoy our work in the field of this world in the days and weeks to come? This is a topic that we didn't cover in seminary. I got to do a little more research on this one than I normally do. Still maybe not enough. I'm sure there's things here that you know that I don't know about Easter traditions or Easter-linked traditions and where they come from and what meaning may be in them. So with that disclaimer, I was struck to learn as soon as I went on to our worldwide library, which is at all of our fingertips, and began to look at Easter traditions, I was struck to learn that a recent poll showed that 37% of Americans believe that rabbits lay eggs. Perhaps this says something about the systemic decline in critical thinking that I preached about in another congregation a few weeks ago. But you know, I was confused too as a kid. As a kid, at least. And I was not answering the phone at my parents' house talking to pollsters either at that time. But I remember conflating, I had Peter Rabbit of Mr. McGregor's farm. You know, the little story where he learns to stay home and stay away from the dangers of the world. I conflated that with the Easter Bunny when I was a kid. And I had the two confused. And in my reading for this talk, I found some perhaps a reason for that, at least an excuse, justification. At this age, I'm still looking for justifications of things that happened when I was 5 years old than I did. There's the song about Peter Cottontail. I hadn't heard it for about 50 years. Here comes Peter Cottontail. I won't sing it because I don't want to give you an earworm for all week. But he's hopping down the bunny trail, hippity-hoppity, Easter's on his way, bringing every girl and boy baskets full of Easter joy. Peter Cottontail is bringing the baskets of Easter joy, right? He didn't necessarily lay the eggs, but the Easter bunny is named Peter Rabbit, and Peter Rabbit was also on Mr. McGregor's farm. I just figured the bunny grew up and got a job, right? These are all dreams. These are all myths, right? Carl Jung says, write down your dreams. They are your myths. Write down your dreams. They are your myths. I've taken to doing this over the last 20 years, writing down my dreams from time to time, not religiously, but they are my myths, and they show me The lint that's accumulating in the back of my mind, sometimes it's unfinished business, sometimes it's just ridiculous. You are not necessarily looking for meaning, but sometimes the meaning is going to pop out there. Write down your dreams. They are your myths. They become guideposts. They don't have to be literally true to carry a perspectival truth. But that begs the question. If we have individual dreams that we write down, can we have collective dreams? And I maintain that these are our collective dreams, the myths of Easter, the myths of childhood, the myths of religion, that there is meaning in those myths that may not be literal meaning, but it speaks to the human condition, to the going through of the day, and our going through each day and week and finding meaning there and finding happiness and joy in that work. Collective dreams then can be sort of a collective mythology, like the Easter Bunny. People rising from the dead in many cultures, which, I mean, I took thermodynamics. There's a vanishingly small chance that that could happen. It doesn't mean it ever will happen. Because vanishingly small means, you know, how many hundreds of decimal points before you get to the point one, right? Collective dreams as collective mythology. It's that with that that I offer you some of the more more secular, more humanistic, more pagan myths of Easter than you may be used to hearing in church at Eastertide. There are animal symbols of Easter. Let's have some fun here. Bunny rabbits. Bunny rabbits have fertility and fecundity. They're not only fertile and get pregnant quick, they have a whole lot of babies there and do 5 or 6 or 7 litters a year. You know, that's a lot of rabbits. No wonder we say that things breed like rabbits, right? What a metaphor for spring rebirth, for spring renewal, for second chances, for flowering, for coming out of the cocoon of wintertime and flowering anew, all of nature. The Easter Bunny appears to have arisen as a tradition in Germany. And it was brought to America by the Pennsylvania Dutch, who are anything but Dutch, they're German and Bavarian, and filtered down the Appalachians to Maryland, Virginia, North Carolina, and beyond. It's a tradition that came out of 15th century Germany at least. Eggs and the fertility of new life also are an Easter symbol. Eggs as the fertility of new life. Eggs are more than symbolic. They were forbidden during Lent in the Middle Ages. So you couldn't eat eggs for 40 days and 40 nights. Finally, Easter came along and you could eat eggs again. It made a great gift, right? All the little kids would finally get to eat eggs. A lot of Easter dishes, traditional dishes in other countries, have eggs in them. The most elaborate eggs, in terms of painting the eggs, were as a celebration motif. They were developed. Those egg painting methods were developed in Poland and the Ukraine. The Pisanki eggs to write or design. That's how we say it in southern Poland or southern Ukraine. Pisanki eggs. They were applied they were made by applying wax in patterns, and then you would dye the egg. Then peel off the wax and reapply the wax elsewhere and dye in other colors, so you would end up with multicolored or patterned or striped eggs without buying a kit for them at Walmart. Baby chicks are another of the animal symbols of Easter, representing new life, fertility, and a good bite to eat, starting with the ears, like on Peeps, right? Easter traditions also include other non-animal, but animal-linked motifs. Chocolate Easter eggs, certainly not eggs per se, but they're made as a confection. This was traced to Germany and France in the 1800s, and then to England and to the United States. These were followed by chocolate bunnies and other Easter candies. And carrot cake, since bunnies like carrots. Carrot cake is a big deal on Easter in Hungary. I want to go to Hungary now. We were talking about going to Budapest, visiting Budapest just a few minutes ago. Linda and I were, and I had no idea. Now I've got to go back to Hungary at Easter time and get some carrot cake. Soft pretzels. That became a thing for Easter around 600 CE when a monk came up with the recipe for making bread without eggs, fat, or milk, because these were forbidden by the Catholic Church, which had a lot of sway over people's personal lives at that time. Less sway now, but still some there. But that's an aside. This is Easter. We're not going to go there. Pretzels can be made with just flour, salt, and water. And so they became an Easter thing. The shape also represents supposedly prayer posture with the arms crossed and the hands on the shoulder like a pretzel. Hot cross buns. Anybody ever hear of hot cross buns?
Sure.
Yeah, we've got a few. I had never heard of them before. Dr. Google explained it to me the other day. There's a cross made in icing on a square bun. And seeing people nod. And they're a big deal in Australia, Canada, India, Ireland, New Zealand, in the UK, among other places. They're very ancient too. In the Old Testament, the Israelites baked sweet buns for an idol and got scolded for it. And religious leaders were trying to stop that. The early church clergy also tried to put a stop to sacred cakes being baked at Easter. Oh, you can't, you know, that's idolatrous, right? In the end, there were divine cake-baking pagan women who caused them to give up and bless the cake instead. So, just stay at it. Ham for Easter dinner in the United States. I'm not sure where that comes from. It seems kind of like putting it in the faith of American Jews, but it's lamb, and that's a speculation on my part, but it's lamb instead of ham in Australia and many European countries. Ham, lamb, referring back to the Lamb of God thing in the Christian New Testament. Easter outfits, representing newness and renewal. Easter cards. I don't want to reduce Easter just to a Hallmark holiday, but it is the fourth most popular card holiday, according to American Greetings, after Christmas, Valentine's Day, and Mother's Day. Then there was Easter. I'm not sure where Father's Day got there, but we're not going to worry. Dad's had enough attention. Well, that just reminded me of a few years ago. I'm going to divert completely. We had at my home church, we had a guest minister who was from Tennessee, and he did children's church, and he showed them a star, a flag of Tennessee, and said, "I'm from Tennessee, and this is our flag." And it's like a three colored fields and three stars. And he said, asked the children, "Can you tell me what those three stars represent?" And someone in the audience, an adult in the audience, said, "Oh, those are the three Democrats." Well, we're talking about Easter and Easter cards. In Victorian England, and now you're going to wonder for 30 minutes about, you know, what the three cards are. Stars really mean. They're the three geographic parts of Tennessee. So it worked for North Carolina too, but they thought of it first. There's a tradition in Victorian England where they produced stationery with a rabbit on it and people could put personal greetings. That's where the Easter card tradition started. What about Easter egg hunts and Easter egg rolls? We talked about Easter and decorating Easter eggs and decorating the eggs. But the hunts started in the 1500s in Germany, and they spread around the world with immigration. The first Easter egg roll, who knows what an Easter egg roll is? I never really got that. We don't do that much around here, right? Easter egg rolls are where people roll an egg down a hill, where kids roll an egg down the hill, and the object of the game is to get yours to roll farthest without breaking. So it sounds like a great betting game to teach to kids, to me. The first Easter egg roll was on the White House lawn in 1810. It was organized by Dolly Madison. There are other accounts of the children of Abraham Lincoln and Andrew Johnson, or the Lincolns and the Johnsons. It wasn't just the men who had the children, obviously. There are accounts of them doing it in the 1860s, the first roll on, or there was a, it migrated to Capitol Hill, and kids started going there from all over Washington because it was the best place in Washington, D.C. to have an Easter egg roll. It's pretty flat otherwise. It was a swamp from time immemorial. And so the kids would be rolling the eggs down the hill and yelling, and the windows were open, of course, because there wasn't air conditioning in the day. In April, you've got to have air conditioning, right? And the lawmakers were upset. And so they passed a law in 1876 that was signed into law by President Grant. It was called the Turf Protection Law. It was written to prevent, quote, any portion of the Capitol grounds and terraces from being used as a playground or otherwise. I'm not sure what otherwise refers to. So far as may be necessary to protect the public property, turf, and grass from destruction and injury. So next year, it rains, there was no roll. And the year after that, the police ran the kids off. And President Hayes invited them to the South Lawn as an alternative. And that's where we got the permanent official White House Easter egg roll. Because it's kind of hilly there. It's a decent place for a roll. Probably would be better on the Capitol steps, but the Capitol Hill. But it's probably not going to happen. There are international customs that we can think about. The Easter egg tree in Germany, where they would blow eggs out through a pinhole and paint the eggs, and the kids would hang the eggs on a tree to symbolize the new life of spring. In Australia, bunnies are considered pests. They're not going to celebrate with bunnies, so they are replaced with bilby. Bilbies in Australia are a marsupial that has large ears, huge ears, and a more pointy nose than bunnies, and they work just fine. In Poland, boys try to soak people with buckets of water. I suppose girls can soak people with buckets of water too. That's all rooted in baptism, in the baptism of the Polish prince Mieszko. So we say it in southern Poland again. On Easter Monday in 996, so that's a long time to have your baptism celebrated in a fun and games way. In Greece, people do an annual pot throwing tradition where they throw pots out of windows. I suppose these are old pots they don't want anymore. On Easter Sunday, to mark the start of spring and to commemorate new crops being gathered in new pots. Where did Easter come from? Not just as a word, but as an event. Bede, a monk from the 1700s, claimed that Easter derived from Eostre, the Anglo-Saxon goddess of spring. Could be related to Ishtar, Easter, Eostre, Ishtar, the Babylonian goddess of love and fertility. That's remained unverified by modern scholars. It could be true. Alternatively, there's a Norse word, Easter, or Ostara, which meant the season of the growing sun. The season of the growing sun. I like that. S-U-N, or season of new birth. Our word east comes from those same root words. So in this case, Easter would be linked to the changing of the season, to pagan and earth-centered traditions, our source 6. The month before, Anglo-Saxon month before April was named Eostre Monat, or Easter month, hence the application to the Christian holiday that happened to fall within it. Why did it fall within that time? Because in the Christian New Testament, Jesus has dinner, the Last Supper, as the Passover meal as his last meal with his disciples. And so we would know that Easter fell that year, or his resurrection. Resurrection, yeah, that he would have been crucified the next day, which was actually Passover. He had it a day early because stuff was going down in his life. And he was tried that night, crucified on Friday, and supposedly was resurrected on Sunday morning. So it's observed in Christian tradition as the Sunday following Passover in the Orthodox Christian tradition. The emperor in the 1500s wanted to separate it completely from Jewish observances, so he moved it to a different Sunday, or what can fall on a different Sunday. I think it's the first in the Western tradition, Christian traditions, it's the first Sunday after the first full moon after the equinox. So if you got all that, you can figure out when Easter is next year. It's easier to look online and find out, which is what I did. What can we get out of all this? Sure, this is fun. Is it meaningful? One thing I get out of it is a lesson of renewal, a lesson of a second chance. We have a thing at Justice Jobs. We like to look at people and say, I know you feel really bad about your record right now, but it is a it's not a life sentence. It's a lesson learned. It's not a life sentence. That we're all about second chances. Our treasurer at Justice Jobs is an evangelical Christian preacher. He says the best prayers to close our meeting, and he's very sensitive about it because he knows that all of us are not on the evangelical bus. And a few months ago, he said, Lord, you are the God of second chances. I love that. The God of second chances. A lesson of renewal, all of these things point to a second chance until we have no more second chances as people, as communities, as a world. That calls to mind the McDougal piece that we read from the reflection. That we have a second chance and we need to continue to exercise that second chance as long as we've got a shot at it. These things, these thoughts about Easter, these traditions, these collective community myths, they're a lesson that we should be having fun as well as working. That we don't have to work, that we don't have to be glum and keep our heads down. We can still keep our humor. Sometimes it may be graveyard humor, but it's still humor. Life must not be a drudge. Even if the work we're doing is of importance for saving the planet or saving humanity, life must not be a drudge. I will not let somebody run me out of the fun of living. As far as we know, we're the only beings in the universe who are aware of our own self-awareness. I'm sure, though, that there are other animals, and not just mammals, who have fun. Why do birds sing? Scientists have dug and dug and dug at that question. Is it mating? Is it communication? Is it this and that? Doesn't account for all of their singing. Over and over again, I've read where scientists have suggested, well, maybe it just feels good. Maybe it's just fun. And then there's a third piece there, in addition to renewal and a second chance, and in addition to having fun with things, that these points about Easter bring me back to. And that is a lesson that and here I'm going to pivot a bit, if pagan and secular traditions can be useful to helping us have meaning, so can Jewish and Christian traditions if they're viewed fairly and viewed intelligently and realistically in the modern world. Our fourth tradition is more than a historical oddity and curiosity. Our fourth, not said tradition, but our fourth source, Jewish and Christian traditions, is more than a historical curiosity that was part of Unitarianism and Universalism 200 years ago, but is no more. We have much to learn from African-American biblical interpretation. I took a course under Dr. Shively Smith, who at the time was one of 25 black women who had a terminal degree in African-American biblical interpretation. I felt like I was sitting at the knee of the master. She's moved on to Boston University now. But she taught us and helped us learn about and teach ourselves about core narratives of the Black church in America, what she calls the Black church. It's just not organized as the Black church, but it's a sociological thing. African-American interpretation, or hermeneutics as it's called in seminaries, the interpretation method of African-American Black church starts from a hermeneutic of suspicion, an interpretation that involves suspicion. They start questioning the motives of people who created the canons, the books that were selected for the holy writings, the holy book, and also it questions the traditional or privileged interpreters and comes up with some amazing things. If you want a bite of that, go home and pull up Krista Tippett's remit from this morning. It was a replay with Aviva Zornberg, who studies the story of Exodus and all the meaning for contemporary life that's in that story. You will find that despite that on the whole, or in general, to generalize a bit, the Black church in America finds the story of Moses and the Exodus much more enlightening and much more a root narrative for their theology than they find the resurrection story. No wonder. People held in slavery halfway around the world from where they started from, before they're forcibly removed, they do not need to be forgiven metaphysically. It would be much more appropriate for them to be paying attention to a deliverance story like Exodus, "Let my people go," right? And this is where Dr. Martin Luther King came up with a lot of his stuff, was out of the Hebrew Bible. Let justice roll down like waters, righteousness like a running stream. Did he make that up? No, it's Amos 5:24. And the 12, 14 verses before that are deeply rooted in a system of agriculture in the Northern Kingdom in 750 BCE that was all about agribusiness and exploiting poor people, exploiting laborers. It relates to today in America and in the world. It's not a dead book. There's plenty of lessons there for us to learn and live by. My favorite, and I'll close with this, is Genesis 2 and 3 as an echo of what happened in 8,000-9,000 BCE to cause people coming out of the forest to settle down and start farming. And the story in Genesis 2 and 3, if you view the sin or mistake in the garden as having nothing to do with the decline in individual ethics where a couple of people did something horribly wrong and changed the history of all humanity for it, but if you reinterpret this as a decline in community ethics, which as humans impressed other humans into communities that cultivated grains starting about 9,000 years ago, and there's scientific evidence that that didn't happen without violence, that violence was caused to do that. Why would you go from a hunter-gathering lifestyle where you're working 15 to 20 hours a week to support for your basic needs and you got the rest of the time as leisure time, why would you go from that to working 60, 80 hours a week, having your bones broken by taskmasters in the fields, unless force was involved? What I'm talking about here is viewing the Christian and Jewish sources for what they are and what they can be as lessons on a restoration of community ethics. A lot of times a book can be more valuable for telling you how not to act or to act in an opposite way than it is taking it just on face value as a positive. So if we look at it as lessons toward a restoration of community ethics, towards a radical restoration of other-centeredness and non-competitiveness, then that would give humanity a chance if we would learn that lesson. That chance may seem bleak, but it may be the only chance we have. So I suggest that we work towards that restoration, one person at a time, one family at a time, one congregation, one country, and one Easter egg roll at a time, and have some fun while we're doing it. Our closing hymn this morning is number 38, "This Morning Has Broken," number 38. Small, but I like the chocolate ones best of them all.